Well, good morning, and can I welcome everybody to this, the 13th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. We've received apologies this morning from both Colin Beattie and Willie Coffey, but I'm delighted to welcome Bill Kidd, who's substituting on the committee today. The first item on the agenda is for members of the committee to consider whether or not to agree to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The principal item on our agenda is an evidence session on the Audit Scotland report NHS in Scotland 2022, which was a section 23 report. I just in the interest of transparency, want to refer members to my register of interest, which includes the membership of two trade unions that organise in the National Health Service. But I'm especially pleased this morning to welcome our three witnesses, who are Caroline Lamb, who's the Chief Executive of NHS Scotland and the Director General of Health and Social Care, Richard McCallum, who's the Director of Health, Finance and Governance in the Scottish Government, and John Burns, who's the Chief Operating Officer in NHS Scotland. You are all very welcome here this morning. We've got quite a number of questions we would like to put to you, but before we get to those, Caroline Lamb, could I ask you to make a short opening statement?
Absolutely, thank you. Thank you, Convener. I welcome this report and indeed the close engagement between Audit Scotland and my team, which is so important. The new First Minister has set out his priorities for this parliamentary session, which include a determined focus on the recovery, reform and improvement of NHS and social care services. Audit Scotland's report clearly sets out the challenges that the NHS and social care face as a result of the pandemic and notes that COVID and other respiratory viruses continue to impact on services. Their report highlights our focus on recovery, which has included a successful vaccination drive and a significant reduction in two-year outpatient waits. Ministers have met the commitment to provide over £1 billion of additional funding for health and social care in 23-24, taking the total allocation to over £19 billion. It is for me to ensure that that funding is used effectively to drive the reforms that are needed and to ensure that people receive the treatment that they need as quickly as possible. The First Minister, the Health Secretary and myself understand the importance of reducing hospital occupancy to ease flow and to improve capacity for urgent, unscheduled and planned care. We'll do that through increasing capacity in primary, community and social care. NHS 24 and the Scottish Ambulance Service have successfully increased the number of people that they are helping without needing to attend A&E. And this report also notes other work that we're doing to increase our capacity to care for people outside hospital. And about 97% of discharges take place without any delay. But addressing the remaining 3% that are delayed and their impact on the whole system is of critical importance. We've worked hard with partners in health and social care to understand the actions that improve discharge flow. And we'll continue to support systems to improve those actions over the coming months. Central to our recovery is, of course, the £1 billion NHS recovery plan. That includes increasing activity through the establishment of national treatment centres, through investment in mobile theatres and diagnostic facilities, and through using the Centre for Sustainable Delivery to maximise the impact of the resources that we already have. And there are some indicators of success. Scotland's A&Es continue to be the best performing in the UK for over 7 years, and an average of 591 operations were performed each day in February. That's 15% higher than in January. Of course, we all want to go further and faster, but we do need to acknowledge the progress that has been made given the continuing shock resulting from the pandemic. Convener, I'd like to finish by once again thanking our exceptional health and social care staff. And myself and my colleagues are very happy to take your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Can I just begin by asking whether or not you accept and agree with the findings and recommendations of the Auditor General?
Yes, I think we do accept the findings of the Auditor General, and we will want to work with colleagues across health and social care systems to ensure that we take forward some of the recommendations in this report. We accept absolutely that the NHS is in very challenging times, and we are all focused on trying to navigate a path through that.
Okay, thanks. So do you accept then the point that's made by the Auditor General in paragraph 99, that the wording of new targets is open to interpretation? So there is a question mark about whether waiting time targets are properly useful and transparent for people. And of course, the report also notes in paragraph 105 that the Office for Statistics Regulation deliberated that the statistics produced by the Scottish Government on waiting times could be misleading because they are based on median waiting times. So do you accept that criticism?
So what I would say, Convener, is that we are absolutely determined to be transparent and open with the public, with yourselves, with Audit Scotland, and Audit Scotland do also attend our regular assurance meetings. It is a very complex picture. Planned care, unfortunately, is impacted by the pressures on urgent and unscheduled care. We are working with NHS boards and through national modelling to try, and I'm sure John, and as we come to later questions, John will say a bit more about the work that we're doing around both national and local modelling, particularly for planned care. In terms of the specifics around the online waiting times platform, that was developed in collaboration with Public Health Scotland and NHS 24 with the intention of providing information about typical waits, which I'm sure you'll appreciate is a very, very complex picture. It uses statistics that are quality assured and collated by Public Health Scotland, and we are continuing to improve that with updates already having been made to provide more information and to link to the official statistics sites.
Okay, but we had an exchange of correspondence just about a year ago, and you replied to me on the 13th of May saying at that time, we are committed to being open and transparent about data on waiting times performance. And yet, several months later, an Audit Scotland report comes out, which points out not only have you been criticised by the Office for Statistics Regulation because your waiting time target information isn't transparent, but you're also criticised in a similar vein by the Auditor General.
And I think, as I've said, Convener, you know, we are committed to trying to provide transparent waiting time information whilst recognising that that is a very complex picture. We have worked with Public Health Scotland to provide that information. We, Public Health Scotland, have accepted that criticism, and we are looking at, Public Health Scotland are looking at ways in which they can improve that information. So we are committed to being able to provide that information in a transparent and open way.
When can we expect to see that?
I will need to contact Public Health Scotland to get some further information on that, and I will commit to getting back to you on that.
Okay, thank you. One of the areas, again, identified in the Audit Scotland report is about the delays to the rollout of the national treatment centres, which I think we all understand are critical in tackling waiting times, the backlog, but also, I suppose, not just addressing the immediate pressures, but providing a longer-term route for getting people the treatment that they need. I mean, where there's been a delay. Can you tell us where we are in the opening of the national treatment centres, some of which I think were meant to open last year and still aren't open?
Absolutely, Convener. Well, I'm sure, again, colleagues will understand that given the issues around building projects during the pandemic, it's perhaps inevitable that we would see some delays. However, the national treatment centres in both Fife and Highland are now open, and the national treatment centres in Forth Valley and the extension to Golden Jubilee are on track for the end of this year. But those first two, the treatment centres in Fife and Highland are open under our now treating patients. In relation to the rest of the programme, that programme is in different stages around the preparation and proper scrutiny, as you would appreciate, of business cases and working with NHS Assure to ensure that we're providing the best possible facilities that we can. Clearly, there have been issues around cost inflation, but those business cases are working through the process. What I would say is that we are not waiting for those national treatment centres for more and more physical premises to come on train. We are also, and I know John will want to say more about this later, we're also very focused on what we can do within our existing estate and how we can increase productivity within that existing estate. And that has included, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, providing mobile facilities to boards to help them to up their activity.
So just to go back to what you said earlier there, you said that the NHS Forth Valley Larbert site treatment centre and the one at the expanded one at the Golden Jubilee in Clydebank will be open by the end of the year. So can you give us a definite commitment that by December of 2023, those two centres will be open and receiving patients?
Yes, they are on track to be opened in December. Yep. Yep.
And are you all, John Burns, are you confident about that?
Yes, we're working very closely with the boards and we are confident that unless there are any unforeseen circumstances, these projects are on track to be opened by the end of the year.
Okay. And so if we take the Golden Jubilee site as an example, if that's open by the end of the year, how does that compare to when you expected it to be open when the construction work was originally procured?
I think we'll need to come back to you on that one. Clearly, there's been a number of changes as we've gone through the pandemic, so I will come. I'll commit to providing that information to the committee.
But you accept that there's been a delay?
Yes, inevitably there has been a delay, as we've seen with most building projects that have been on site during the pandemic.
Yeah, well, as a committee, we're used to delays, and sometimes they aren't as inevitable as you perhaps are suggesting. What does that do then to the cost of those projects? Is it going to come in on budget or is it going to be over budget because there is a time delay?
So our expectation, Richard, do you want to... expectation is...
Yeah, so in terms of the projects that have already been built, we've had an agreed budget through the outline business case. When they are then returned with the final business case, with the full business case, we would expect them to be in line with those full business cases because of the infrastructure inflation that we're seeing. There is risk to that, and we're seeing that across all our infrastructure programmes at the moment. However, you know, that final business case, if there are any deviations from that, we would be expected to be informed by the project as it moves towards completion.
But, sorry to labour the point, but I mean, what is the budget, for example, for the Larbert site? What is the budget, for example, for the Golden Jubilee site? And you know, where does that now sit? Mm-hmm.
So I'll come back with a detail. I don't want to kind of quote a figure that's not correct on those two sites. So we'll make sure that for all the NTCs, you've got that breakdown of the initial budget and where that spend is against those programmes.
Okay, because a lot of this morning's discussion will be about the financial pressures that are on the National Health Service. And, you know, Caroline Lamb, you're the accountable officer responsible for £19 billion worth of public money. So it's quite important that we get an understanding that you're on top of these pressures that you are facing. I'm going to turn to Craig Hoy, who's got some questions to put to you. Craig.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ms Lamb. I just want to refer to the Scottish Fiscal Commission Fiscal Sustainability Report that came out last month, which raised serious concerns about the future financial pressures on the NHS in Scotland. And they identified that this wasn't just due to an ageing population, but also due to rises in chronic health conditions and also the technological advances that are moving us forward. What are you and the NHS in Scotland now doing to plan for these future financial pressures to ensure that Scotland's NHS is actually financially sustainable?
Yeah, thanks very much for that question. So we are clearly very mindful of the pressures that result from the demographics, from the ageing population, We also look at the Scottish burden of disease information with a view to looking at the likely demand on health and indeed social care services going forwards. And we also have our Innovation Design Authority and Accelerated Adoption Programme to look at the innovations that actually can help a lot of the time to address some of that pressure. So, as I said in my opening remarks, the investment in NHS Scotland is at an all-time high. It's sitting at £19 billion. We need to make sure that that money is spent in the best way possible. So we do absolutely look in our projections going forward at what that additional burden of disease looks like. I think key to that is actually looking at what we can do, not just from within the health and social care portfolio in Scottish Government, but across government, to improve population health and to address health inequalities, a lot of which are rooted in social inequalities. So that's about tackling poverty, tackling poor housing, tackling educational attainment. All of those things contribute towards improving population health and therefore helping us to mitigate some of that increasing demand on healthcare services. We also are looking at the way, I said again in my introduction remarks, that we're looking at how we can increase capacity in primary, community and social care with a view to ensuring that people who are in hospital in the most sort of high-end part of our system are there when they really need to be there and can be treated elsewhere and closer to home where that is appropriate. So, again, huge work in the run-up to next winter and huge work to last winter, sorry, and in the run-up to next winter around looking at how we can use NHS 24 and SAS, use the ambulance service, particularly in the community, to prevent people from being admitted to hospital. I think the point about innovation is a really good one as well. So, yes, there are expensive drugs, expensive innovations coming over the horizon, but equally, innovation, the use of digital technologies, presents us with the opportunity to actually deliver healthcare in a different way and to deliver healthcare closer to people. There are lots of good examples where we've been using colon endoscopy as an example as part of our approach to diagnostics, where we are rolling out digital dermatology, which again saves people from having to travel into a hospital, and also closed loop diabetes, which helps people to manage their insulin levels in a way which helps to prevent some of that burden of illness from developing in the future. So we are looking at this from multiple directions.
The Scottish Fiscal Commission estimates that the projected spending on health in Scotland will rise from 30% to 50% within 50 years. Is that a number that you recognise? And what sort of conversations would you be having now with ministers about the model of healthcare in Scotland, given that projected shift in spending?
So I think a lot of that is relates back to what I've just said in my answer. So this is about how we can provide services in it, how we can reduce demand, so improve population health to try and take out some of that pressure on services. And that is a cross-government initiative piece of work. That is about what we can do to actually reduce social inequalities that feed into health inequalities and feed into poor health and poor health outcomes for people. So this is about reducing demand. It's also about what we can do, and there's been huge progress made in some of our out-of-hospital pathways, providing care to people in their own homes rather than in hospital. So it's about doing more of that as well. And about then really embracing and adopting innovation. I suspect that over the next few years we're going to see more potential from artificial intelligence and from other areas. So yes, I think our job is to look to make sure that we are absolutely focused on what we can do to make sure that we're providing health and social care services in a way that meets the needs of the population but is sustainable in the context of overall budgets.
Obviously, that's a long-term sustainability issue. Shorter term, I think a meeting of NHS board chiefs in September of last year, that was, I think, the draft minutes were, obviously, that meeting were leaked, identified a particular potential £1 billion black hole within the SNP, within the NHS's finances within Scotland. That meeting of NHS bosses did say that they'd been given the green light to almost think the unthinkable about the foundations of the NHS in Scotland, potentially having the wealthy pay for the treatment and a potential two-tier NHS. Is that the kind of discussion that is taking place within NHS Scotland?
No, that's not the kind of discussion that's taking place in Scotland. And I am on record as having said that I did not give a green light to discussions about challenging the very foundations of NHS Scotland. I meet really regularly with chief executives in NHS Scotland, and at least monthly. And we talk about where our opportunities are for cost improvement, for delivering services differently, for delivering services in a better way. We talk about that all the time. And absolutely, I would not want anything to be off the table in terms of how we can provide services differently in a way that supports people in the way that they need to be supported. But that is not about challenging the foundations of the way in which NHS Scotland was built.
OK, I accept that, but the draft minutes of that meeting does say that somebody gave, quotes, the green light to present what boards feel reform may look like, and then fundamentally they say areas which were previously not viable options are now possibilities. What would those viable options be then?
So can I just be clear about the genesis of those minutes? So my understanding, so that was not a meeting that I was present at. My understanding was that was also not a meeting of NHS chief executives. It was a meeting of, I think there was maybe one chief executive there and some of the function, what we call functional leads, so people who chair the other groups, medical directors, nursing directors, directors of planning, as an example. I wasn't at the meeting, so I can't describe the context within that which that conversation took place. But from my review of the minutes, it looks a little bit like that was a bit of a sort of blue sky thinking, and not with a view to thinking that all the things they were proposing were reasonable and would be taken forward by Scottish Government.
We know from recently released data that there's been a 73% increase in Scots electing to go private for certain treatments. If I, as NHS chief executive, if I was 80, what would you advise me to do? If I was 80, in pain, immobile, suffering from social isolation as a result of requiring a hip replacement, for example, and I had the means to do it, what would you advise me to do now?
So I would not want anybody to be in pain and suffering, and none of that is not the position that any of us or any of our chief execs want anybody to be in. That is why we have had a focus on trying to reduce the longest waits on our waiting lists, and also on trying to support people to live well while they are waiting. So absolutely, I'm not about advising people on individual choices, but I know my commitment and our commitment is to do whatever we can in the face of many challenges, particularly around the pressures on urgent and unscheduled care, to maintain that planned care programme and to bring particularly the long waits down as quickly as we possibly can.
But would you accept that at this point in time when, for example, I've got a correspondence from a constituent who has had to borrow money from their children in order to have a hip operation, that's kind of unacceptable at this point in time, and you can truly understand why people are making the choice to do that in very challenging circumstances?
As I've already said, that is not a position that we would want anybody to be in, and that is a position that we are working across the system. And I think, you know, you could talk to any chief executive across the system, and that is something that they're absolutely trying to address in the face of, as I've said, very challenging circumstances. And where COVID has not gone away, we still had over 1,000 people in our hospitals with COVID in March this year.
Okay. Just turning to back to the Audit Scotland report, it identifies that the creation of the National Care Service requires, and I quote, a significant unknown financial commitment to be met from the Scottish Government's health and social care budget. As you're obviously aware, ministers have determined that they will pause stage one of the bill. Does this delay have any financial implications for the health and social care budget in Scotland overall in this year or future years?
So the budget for this year is set, and we will work within that budget. There will obviously then be a process in terms of setting the budget for future years. You are quite correct that the timetable for stage one of the National Care Service Bill has been extended, and that is very clearly with a view to enabling further consultation and identifying areas where we can reach consensus. And at this stage, I think it's very difficult to say what the financial implications of that will be, but we are committed to producing a revised financial memorandum.
And in terms of the financial memorandum that accompanied the bill, that identified a cost somewhere in the region of £1.3 billion that's been contested. The Auditor General said that you really couldn't come to a final conclusion as to whether that number was accurate or not. Is there a concern that if the total costs of establishing and operating the National Care Service, if it does come to fruition, are higher than that, that we end up cutting into health expenditures as a result?
So I think we need to be clear that the financial memorandum didn't contain a commitment to spend that money. That needs to go through business case processes and budgeting processes as well. So there is a whole process of scrutiny that we would need to undertake before committing that sort of level of expenditure. And as I've said, you know, there is also now a process of just taking a moment to do some more engagement with stakeholders, particularly the trade unions and local government, with a view to how we might take that work forward. The bill, implicit in the bill, has always been a commitment to co-design with people, and that does make it very difficult to pin down absolute financials. Richard, is there anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, I suppose just a couple of things. The financial memorandum contained a range of costs, and it was over that five-year period in terms of that setup. And that started from a relatively small sum in 22-23, around about 10 million. And I think, as indicated by the then Deputy First Minister in 23-24, a plan for around 50 to 60 million of spend. Now, obviously, there's with the policy prospectus, and what was set out by ministers over the last week or so, you know, we will review that and we'll scrutinise the costs both in 23-24 and the appropriateness of those and the future year projections as well. And I think that, you know, absolutely key. You know, we want to make sure, you know, whilst there will undoubtedly be that scrutiny from here and from Audit Scotland, you know, this has to not just be about additional spend, it's about reform in the system as well, and that change and improvement that we know needs to come in social care, and that will be the focus of that financial business case that Caroline's mentioned.
Just for clarity, the Scottish Government's initial commitment was to introduce a National Care Service in the lifetime of this Parliament. It appears now it's to legislate for a National Care Service in the lifetime of this Parliament. Just for clarity, what is the timetable that you've been instructed to work towards?
So we are currently working towards the extended timetable for stage one of the bill, and that does involve further consultation with stakeholders over the course of the summer, which will then drive the rest of the timetable.
Fine. And just before I pass on, obviously we've talked about financial sustainability within the NHS, and you've identified that reform and innovation are all obviously going to be critical to the long-term sustainability of the NHS in Scotland. There was clearly that meeting where there was blue skies thinking. We need to engage the public at some stage in relation to what healthcare looks like in Scotland for 5, 10, 15, 25, 50-year timetable. What is your intention in terms of how you engage the that conversation with the nation about our National Health Service?
So I think that's a question for ministers.
Okay. Well, I've got just a quick follow-up question for you, which is based on the Audit Scotland report. Again, you said at the start that you agreed with the findings and recommendations. So one of the headline findings is, and I quote the report, "The proposed National Care Service will place a huge strain on the health and social care budget." I mean, do you accept that conclusion?
So what I accept is that there is a real requirement for social care reform. I think I've been really clear that the commitment to the financial memorandum is not a commitment to spend money. We need to go through budgeting processes, and we need to work our way through all of that. So I think that there is that the Audit Scotland raised some questions about the requirement for social care reform, but there is also a question about how that is tackled going forward in budget. So we are working to the budget that we have for the current year, and then there will need to be further discussions about what budget is made available to the portfolio in future years.
So, but it's been questioned by the Auditor General, and it was also questioned pretty heavily, wasn't it, by the Finance and Public Administration Committee of the Parliament, who told you that you needed to go back and do your sums again and come back with a revised financial memorandum. And I can't remember a time before when that was necessary for a government department to revise its financial memorandum, because it was seemed to be so out of sync with what people estimated the costs were going to be. I mean, do you feel quite embarrassed about that?
Clearly, we want to get this right, and I think what we do accept is that the bill is framework legislation, and therefore there is a huge reliance on co-design in terms of working out the detail of that, and I think that's one of the challenges that we have had in terms of the financial memorandum. But I think, as Richard's already said to you, that, and as I said earlier, we have a process to go through on that around robust business cases and around including that in the preparation of budgets, of annual budgets as well.
Yeah, and I suppose it also does depend, doesn't it, on the model that's chosen. So at the moment it's envisaged to be a largely commissioning model, whereas at one time we were told it was going to be the modern day equivalent of the foundation of the National Health Service, which is a very different model again from the one that's been put forward so far in the National Care Service Bill.
And as I've said, we are looking to the timetable for stage one has been extended, and there will be consultation around what the best approach is going forward.
Okay. I'm going to turn now to Bill Kidd, who's got some questions to put to you. Bill.
Thank you very much, convener, and welcome today. It's nice to see you here. Can I just ask some more on financial sustainability? And the fact that the Scottish Government's health budget, we've been informed, has increased by £4.4 billion since 2018-19, and that in 23-24 the Scottish budget total allocation for health and social care is placed at £19.1 billion, which has been brought forward a couple of years from where it was expected to be at £19 billion. However, NHS board's financial plans have shown that 14 of the 14 in territorial boards, only three are expected to break even in 22-23 if their savings targets are met, and seven of the eight national NHS boards are expected to break even if their savings targets are met. So on that basis, can I ask whether the Scottish Government has any update on the number of boards that did break even in 22-23, please?
Yeah, Richard, do you want to tell us?
Yeah, so this is obviously still subject to audit, but we've had the year-end position from all 22 health boards now. And what we expect, as I say, subject to audit, is that 16 of the health boards will meet the financial balance in 22-23. Two further boards will be within 1% of their target outturn, and as the Audit Scotland report refers to, that's an agreed parameter that we look to. The further four boards will be further adrift in terms of that outturn position, and so which is actually in some ways a similar position to where we were pre-pandemic. So there is further follow-up scrutiny now and work with them, particularly looking ahead to their 23-24 plan. So that's where we are in terms of the 22-23 outturn. The question of you know what's in, I think it's Appendix 2 of the Audit Scotland report, which shows at that point only three boards being forecasting balance. I think what we see often is boards at the start of the year reflecting a lot of the significant savings that they might have, but not necessarily as those savings start to be developed and delivered. And so there's sometimes that, you know, what's forecast at the start of the year, you will see that improvement as we move through the financial year. And that's obviously something key for us now as we look ahead to 23-24, and we work with the boards in terms of their plans for the current financial year as well.
Okay, well, thank you. But on the basis that you did mention COVID-19 and et cetera, and the specific expenditures that were brought about there, are there plans, and if what are they, to support NHS boards to continue to reduce whilst monitoring COVID-19?
Yeah. So I think, you know, the points that Audit Scotland make up front in the key messages around inflation, pay pressures, ongoing COVID costs, rising energy costs, I mean, I wouldn't disagree with any of those points. That's absolutely true. And that is placing a pressure on our health boards that we've not seen in previous years. Specifically on the COVID-19 challenge, for two financial years, we had additional COVID consequentials to support those COVID costs. In 22-23, that was stopped. And so we've had to plan on the basis of not receiving those future COVID consequentials. And so it's been necessary, as we've budgeted and as we've planned, to think about those COVID costs within the overall NHS budget, the overall £19 billion that you referred to. So we need to work with the boards to challenge, to scrutinise those specific COVID costs, and where possible to bring those down as far as we possibly can. But we need to recognise that a number of those costs will continue. And some of that will need to be managed within the board's existing resource, the baseline budget that they receive. However, we will provide specific additional funding for certain specific programmes. So, for example, the vaccinations programme in 23-24, we're planning to allocate £140 million to support the vaccinations programme. Similarly, with the ongoing work around test and protect, we're planning to allocate a further £80 million in relation to that. So some of it will need to be managed within that core resource, as other spend is in the NHS, but some of it we will provide specific allocations for as well.
Okay, so I mean, but that's revision then of the current brokerage arrangements then with the boards between the government and the NHS boards, is it?
So for 2 years, we paused brokerage arrangements in the context of COVID and the uncertainty around both spend and funding. I think that was, we certainly saw that as a sensible approach to take. I think now we're moving back into a scenario where we want to be much clearer up front about budgets at the start of the year and indeed what we expect boards to deliver. Those brokerage arrangements will continue and remain in place. What's absolutely key, though, with that is that boards need to have a credible plan. So if brokerage is required, then there needs to be that credible plan to show how that repayment will be made. And that's what we're now working with those four boards I mentioned earlier to deliver on.
Okay, well, thank you. But, I mean, does that mean then that the Scottish Government still intends to, as was announced, double investment in the health capital maintenance backlog budget over the next 5 years, or has that been affected by the monies which have had to be allocated for the COVID circumstance?
Yeah, so, compared to the revenue budget, the capital budget for health and social care is, you know, much smaller. It's around £400 to £500 million per annum, or it is currently. What we are intending to do, and this remains the commitment over the course of this Parliament, is to see that investment in our backlogs and to increase. So of that £400 to £500 million that I mentioned, some of that is for our new builds, the national treatment centres that we've already referred to, but some of that's particularly to support targeting some of our existing estate and the backlog we have there. So currently we spend about £150 to £190 million specifically on that backlog maintenance. What we intend to do through to 25-26 and 26-27 is double that to beyond £300 million.
Okay, and this is taken into account, as I think was mentioned earlier by Mr Hoy, in terms of the ageing population and such like, and the extra monies which will have to be generated in order to take up that capacity?
Yeah, I mean, I'm jumping in here. Caroline might want to say more, but yeah, certainly in terms of specifically on the capital and infrastructure, I think one of the key things that we need to do and reflect is that point about the ageing demographics, and actually the design of hospitals and indeed our estates programme more generally needs to look at that wider service plan so that we're planning for the 30, 40 years ahead that Mr Hoy mentioned earlier.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just take you back to what you said in reply to Bill Kidd's opening questions? Did you suggest that the figure that's in the Audit Scotland report was that only three out of the 14 territorial NHS boards were expected to break even was just a snapshot at the wrong time?
I wouldn't say it was a snapshot at the wrong time. I think there's a point in time, though, when boards have developed a plan and the numbers that are reflected in the Audit Scotland report show that, and that will have been from board papers. But I think there's as the financial year progresses, boards' financial positions tend to improve, and obviously that's what we've seen in 22-23. So whilst at that point in time, as you say, only three boards were projecting that balance, we've seen boards' financial position improve over the kind of final 6 months of the year, which is why in the 22-23 outturn, we've seen 16 of the 22 boards in financial balance.
Okay, but if that's the case, and so the Audit Scotland report came out in February of this year, but just 2 days ago in this Parliament, the chief executive of NHS Dumfries and Galloway told a committee, the Health Committee of this Parliament, this. He said, "I've worked in the NHS since the 80s. I am finance director by background. I have never seen a position as challenging as this." And he then went on to speak about an existential challenge to our current service models. And he said, he went on to say, "I technically can't afford 1 in 10 of my workforce." So, there is severe pressure, isn't there, on these territorial health boards? And it sounds a bit more like the picture painted by Audit Scotland than it looks like the picture that you've painted for us this morning.
So I think what Richard has reflected there is the position that boards maybe start off with and the assumptions that they make, and then the work that they do during the course of the year to improve that position. So the explanation that Rich has just given you relates to 22-23. The chief executive of NHS, Dumfries and Galloway, was talking about the position for 23-24. And, you know, I have no doubt that many boards are looking at a very, very challenging position going into 23-24. That said, we would expect, as we did last year, to work with boards through the course of this year. We have a National Sustainability and Value Programme, which Richard might want to say a little bit more about, in terms of how we're working with boards to support all of our NHS boards to identify and deliver savings and efficiencies, in order to manage that through to a better position.
Yeah, and just to be clear, I'm absolutely not underestimating the scale of the financial challenge. And as I say, the key messages from Audit Scotland, you know, I completely agree with in terms of those ongoing COVID pressures, the pay inflation that we're seeing, and the wider inflation. I think that's absolutely right. And we do go into 23-24. With a significant financial challenge that we will need to work through, and that is a reality of those system pressures. And I think, again, as Audit Scotland have said, we're not alone in NHS Scotland in terms of some of those particular pressures that they highlight in those reports. I think two things I would say, though, specifically on the point you raise about Dumfries and Galloway, and indeed where we are at the start of the year. Dumfries and Galloway do have particular challenges. So I mentioned those four boards that aren't in financial balance at the year end. Dumfries and Galloway is one of those. So one of the things that we're doing at the moment is working very closely with Dumfries and Galloway around review of their outturn position and the next steps in terms of 23-24. So there are specific challenges in that health board. Second thing I would say is Caroline touched on the sustainability and value programme. That's absolutely right. So there's a number of things in relation to our system improvements and around our efficiency programme where we can go further, and we will need to go further, whether that's in relation to our procurement practices, some of our work around agency spend and medical locums, which we're working with the health boards on as well. And I guess the final dimension I would say as well is we have obviously settled or are settling the pay awards. That is still an ongoing position in England at the moment. And there is a question about consequentials and whether they may come through or not. And I think that is presenting some challenges, that's understandable in some ways. But the sooner I think we get some clarity as well about that position, that will help as well in terms of potential additional consequentials, which that position is still to be clarified on as well.
Okay, thank you. And yes, we'll watch that with interest. I mean, you've used the word challenging a few times. I mean, I just think for the record, it's worth noting that the word that's used by the auditor general is that the financial position, this is paragraph 17 of the report, the financial position of the NHS in Scotland is concerning. So there is, I think, a suggestion in there that things are not as they should be, and that there are potential consequences for the kind of treatment that people can expect to get. Can I turn to what I suppose is at the heart of many of the questions that we're asking you this morning, and that is how long the Scottish Government thinks it will take to clear the current backlog and fully recover healthcare services to a pre-pandemic level?
So I'll maybe come to John for some detail around this. So we are engaged we have been engaged now for some time in planning and scenario planning, because, you know, as I explained earlier, when we go through the winter months, or it doesn't have to be the winter months, where we've seen peaks in COVID and we have surges in our hospital sector, that does impact on planned care as well. So we are looking at planning both in terms of at a Scotland level, but also then working with NHS boards to convert that into local plans, and to look to see what more we can deliver out of the system in terms of productivity gain, in terms of the sort of mobile units I talked about earlier and others. But John, do you want to say a bit more about that?
Yeah, thank you. So as has been said, we're working very closely with all of the health boards across Scotland to do a number of things. Firstly, to make sure that we are maximising the improvement opportunities that have been identified, whether that's colon capsule endoscopy, whether it's cytosponge, looking also at some improvements that we can make to outpatients in terms of patient-initiated review or ensuring that we have good referral triage at referral point to ensure patients are treated in the right pathway. So all of that work is, I think, an important part of the improvements, and we've seen already the positive impact from that work in terms of capacity. Other areas that we are focused on, and again, there are good examples of maximising our day surgery capacity, but also looking to extend and enhance 23-hour surgery, where a patient will stay in overnight, but it avoids a long inpatient stay. And again, we are seeing more pathways, more surgical pathways being able to be delivered in that shorter stay. And that, of course, also brings new capacity by freeing up main theatres. I think the other thing that we're seeing is that as treatments change, we are able to do some minor treatments using nurse practitioners. And again, that is bringing a capacity that we didn't have previously. So a number of improvement initiatives that we are progressing. We're also working with boards to ensure that we are supporting and protecting their work and planned care. That's a challenge for boards. Of course, they're having to balance all of the demands, unscheduled care and planned care. But we recognise the importance of ensuring that there is a level of protected capacity for planned care so that we continue to make the progress that, that we have seen in recent months in terms of increasing the number of patients that are being treated. We, of course, have the NTCs, and reference has been made to those excellent facilities. And we will be working to ensure these are maximised, having a protected elective capacity where it isn't or doesn't have the potential for being disrupted by emergency and unscheduled care is an important facility in terms of that maximisation. These are national resources, not just local, and so that, again, we're working with boards to make sure that we can allocate appropriately and effectively and as fair a way as possible those facilities. And patients are willing to travel. We hear that they will travel for care, and of course we'll support that. I think the other areas that we're looking at in terms of looking forward, so we're working, as you would expect, this year on our 23-24 delivery plans for planned care to ensure, as I say, these improvements are being maximised. But we're also refreshing and reviewing our modelling. As has been said, you know, it has been, you know, these have been challenging and difficult times in managing through COVID and coming through, and everyone recognises the importance now in doing all we can to recover and to recover forward. So as part of that, we are looking at our modelling for planned care, recognising those improvements that I've said, looking at the NTCs, and then looking at what multi-year delivery would be. This is not, you know, this is not going to be addressed in just a couple of years. So we need to be clear. We need to be ambitious in terms of the delivery, because we recognise, as has been said earlier, there are people on waiting lists who are needing to be to receive that treatment. And I know clinical teams across the country are determined to do all they can to make sure that, that we can do that. So we're in the process of working through those multi-year delivery plans, and then that will inform our next steps, but underpinned by maximising productive opportunity, working with our clinical staff and our clinicians in terms of how best to do this, and making sure we are maximising and delivering on the improvements that will see us use the existing capacity as effectively as possible.
Okay, thank you for that. I mean, so obviously, Mr. Burns, you're using the language of progress and improvement, but when we look as a committee at the Audit Scotland report, I mean, you know, here are two examples. The percent of A&E attendances seen within 4 hours dropped from 83% in December 2019 to just 62% in December 2022. They say in paragraph 37 of this report, delayed discharges increased to the highest level since 2014-15. So that doesn't sound to me like progress and improvement. It sounds not that we're going forwards, but that we're going backwards.
So my early remarks were referencing our work in planned care. I would fully accept that in terms of unscheduled care, as measured by the Accident and Emergency 4-Hour Standard, no one finds that an acceptable position. And again, we are working to deliver improvement to that standard of 4-hour wait. We're working, again, across Scotland, so we have a range of improvement programmes. We are looking at high-impact change. We're looking at the process of discharge to ensure that that is There are, as you know, was said by Caroline earlier, 97% of people are discharged from hospital without delay. But we are seeing longer length of stay in hospital compared to pre-pandemic. And that, of course, is then contributing to the occupied bed days and the occupancy and then the delays through A&E. But what I would say is that we're also looking to deliver care differently. So we have a very effective delivery of our out-of-hospital pathways. So we have seen a doubling of our out-of-hospital bed equivalent capacity in Scotland through hospital at home, through community respiratory pathways, through outpatient parenteral antimicrobial treatment pathways, where we're delivering that care in the community. And we're looking at further ways to extend that through other pathways such as heart failure. And that is, I think, bringing both additional capacity, but it's also enabling our teams across acute and community to deliver care differently. And I think that is that's an important part of how we improve those measures that you've described and how we improve the experience for patients. And we're very focused on delivering those improvements. We're working with our boards, as I say, across Scotland, and boards have their own local improvement plans for making change and to make improvements to that standard.
Okay. And this may be a question for Caroline Lamb, but I mean, one of the criticisms, if I can call it that, I think one of the parts of the analysis that's contained in this Audit Scotland report is that the NHS recovery plan, which was launched in August 2021, one of its flaws was that it didn't come as a result of proper consultation with the territorial health boards at all. And I think there was a commitment, a political commitment perhaps, given that within 100 days of the election in 2021, the NHS recovery plan would be published. But the consequence of that, according to this analysis in this Audit Scotland report, is that the health boards weren't involved in that. I mean, is that a matter of regret to you?
So I think that, you know, clearly we want to, wherever we can, work with boards. What I would say is that the recovery plan that was published in August 2021 was based on what additional capacity we thought we could provide into the system. So that was very much through new areas of work, such as the National Treatment Centres, and also from the work that the Centre for Sustainable Delivery was doing around improvements to create more capacity, particularly in outpatient clinics. We did work very closely with the Centre for Sustainable Delivery, who were in contact with all boards around those opportunities for improvement. But as John's described, you know, as we move forward, and as we, you know, I think again, August 21 was a point in time at which point we thought we might be completely coming out of the pandemic, and then we were hit by Omicron and had to go back much more into COVID management, with, you know, three big peaks of Omicron through 21 going into 22. But as John's described, the work that we have been doing, that we continue to do, is very much around working to look at the picture at a national level and how we can best use national resources, but also very much predicated on working with individual boards around their particular challenges and what we can do to support those.
But again, presumably you agree with the recommendation in the report that the Scottish Government and NHS boards need to work more collaboratively in the future than they have been in the past.
So I absolutely accept that we need to work with our NHS boards, are our key delivery partners, as are our IJBs in relation to social care. So absolutely we need to work with NHS boards. Richard's teams work really closely with boards around their financial position. John's teams work really closely with boards around their trajectories for planned care and for urgent and unscheduled care. So we are working very, very closely with all those partners.
Yeah, but I think the conclusion that's drawn by the Auditor General is that you need to work more closely with the NHS board?
Well, perhaps the Auditor General, given that, you know, again, this is a report in time, I think if the Auditor General were he to look at the range of working that we have going with NHS boards at the moment, the improvements that we've made to the detailed planning guidance, the extent of consultation with NHS boards before we issued that detailed planning guidance, I hope very much that the Auditor General will accept that we have delivered a lot against that recommendation.
OK, well, we've been told a few times it's a moment in time, but the report came out in February of this year. I know we're now in the month of May, yep. But it's not that long ago. Can I just, before I bring Sharon Dowie in, can I just ask, one of the headline recommendations in the Auditor General's report is that you should revisit the NHS recovery plan. Are you doing that? Are you planning to do that?
So the planning that we're doing at the moment with boards is aimed to absolutely get more granular detail around what we can expect to deliver and by when. So in essence, yes, we are going through that work at a very significant level of detail. I think, you know, we've learnt a lot. As I said, that the August 21 report at that point, I think we all maybe over-optimistically thought that we were through COVID, and we weren't, and then we were hit by additional respiratory illnesses last winter as well. So I think we're also very mindful of needing to just play in different scenarios around the impact of those sort of shocks on our planned care system as well.
OK, thanks. I'm going to move on now and invite the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, to put some questions to you. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning. Can I ask what steps the Scottish Government's taking to reduce reliance on bank and agency staff and to reduce the significant increase in expenditure in this?
Yeah, absolutely. So we have been working, we have a short-life working group which is jointly chaired by one of our chief execs, Callum Campbell from NHS Lothian, and our chief nursing officer, Alex McMahon. They've been working through a number of measures aimed at reducing reliance on bank staff, but particularly agency staff, because it's agency staff where we get the extra expenditure, premium expenditure. We've been looking at what measures we can do to enhance recruitment into NHS Scotland. So clearly the call on agency staff comes particularly when the system is under pressure, when we have additional beds open and we're needing to find staff to look after patients in those beds. I think it's important to recognise that overall the workforce in NHS Scotland has increased since pre-pandemic. We're up by about 9.5%. So total whole time equivalent numbers at December 22 were at 156,000 compared to 142,500 pre-pandemic in December 19. But within that, recognising that we are seeing real pressures on urgent and unscheduled care, we have had to open extra beds, and clearly that's leading to a reliance on agency staffing that is much higher than we would want to see. Richard's already reflected the fact that we are the only nation in the UK that hasn't seen industrial action from healthcare staff, and that is really, really welcome in terms of our ability to manage the system, and also reflects the fact that I think that we've made a very good and fair deal with Agenda for Change staff. But we've also been putting into place a number of other initiatives aimed at supporting staff to continue to work in NHS Scotland, to do additional hours for NHS Scotland. So those include our retire to return policy, which is aimed at supporting people who have retired to come back and to work on a flexible basis for NHS Scotland. We have been also looked at allowing boards discretion to look at how they use the pension contributions. That was before the changes to pension legislation was announced, of the tax implications of pensions. We've been seeking to recruit additional staff, additional nursing and allied health professional staff through international recruitment. We achieved 200 additional staff by summer last year, and that encouraged us to allocate additional funding to enable boards to recruit up to an additional 750 staff from overseas. The early indications are that boards have actually exceeded those targets, but that isn't yet. And we're working on looking at that data and hope to be able, in a position to publish it shortly. We're also concerned that we should look quite broadly at entrances into nursing programmes. So again, Alex McMahon, our chief nurse, has been leading a lot of work around the band 2 to 4 in Agenda for Change, with a view to ensuring that those staff have access to opportunities to develop and progress their careers. And that was also linked to us recruiting and creating an additional band 4 post and recruiting into those. So there's a huge amount of work underway which is aimed at ensuring that, that boards have access to staff that doesn't, that reduces their requirement to go to agency and locum staff.
Right, thanks for that. You spoke a lot there about recruitment. What is it you're actually doing to try and retain the staff that you've already got? A large amount of the junior doctors, once they've completed foundational year 2, seem to be taking like a gap year because they're saying that they're overworked and exhausted. So what is it we're doing to actually try and retain the staff that we've actually got? I think I've got figures that say 2021-22, 15,000 NHS workers left the health service. So I know you've just said that we've increased it. Is it 156,000 now compared to 142,000 pre-pandemic? But there's still an awful lot of staff that seem to be leaving, and it seems to be because they're overworked. So what are we doing to try and retain the staff we already have?
So I suppose, you know, in a workforce that size, we are always going to have people leaving through retirement, through change of circumstances. But clearly, we want to try and hang on to as many people as we can. I think part of that has been resolving the pay issues, so and getting to a point where we've made a really good pay offer to Agenda for Change staff. But also, we have encouraged all our boards. We have a national wellbeing hub with around 200,000 folk using resources on that. And that is around supporting people in a rate or signposting people to different resources. So lots of opportunities there. That point about career progression, I think, is really important as well. So in ensuring that those people who want to develop their careers within NHS Scotland have an opportunity to do that and have an opportunity to do that in a flexible way as well. So we're always going to need to keep focusing on recruitment because we are always going to have people retiring, but equally we are very concerned to look at hanging on to the people that we've got as well.
You mentioned the pay, but a lot of it is to do with working conditions as well. And recently I've spoke to some doctors, so some of the comments that they're coming up with is like no compensation or time off in lieu for having to stay late at work or been expected to come in early, no rest facilities for night shift or on calls. Sometimes if they do manage to get a chance to get a break, they're having to put two chairs together to try and get a sleep. Being told that they cannot attend otherwise mandatory teaching sessions as workload and staffing don't allow it. The list does go on. So those student doctors, trainee doctors, they're not going to stay if that's the conditions that they've got when they're doing their training year. So what more are all health boards involved in looking at working conditions for the doctors?
Yeah, so absolutely, absolutely. And we would want to ensure that all health boards have up at the top of their agendas the well-being of their staff. And that includes providing those sort of physical resources so that people can get a break as well. I think in relation to the junior doctors specifically, so clearly we, through NHS Education for Scotland, we do pay attention to the feedback that we get from junior doctors through the trainee survey. And that is part of the overall work that NES do in terms of working with NHS boards where there are issues identified around training programmes for junior doctors and looking to put in place action plans to address those. So there is a mechanism within the system for ensuring and seeking to ensure that the quality of our the training experience for our juniors is as high as it possibly could, because, you know, you're absolutely right. We want these people to have a great a great experience, because we then want them to stay and work in NHS Scotland. And just in terms of that point of people, you know, I understand that when you're involved in an intensive training programme, a lot of people feel that they just need a bit of a break from that. And a number of our boards, John's former board was one of them, have put in place arrangements for clinical development fellows that enables juniors to take a year or more out of quite structured training programmes, maybe gives them a bit more space to think about what are the specialties that particularly interest them and where do they see their futures. And actually, I think it's genuinely recognised by juniors as providing them with a really positive experience. And John, do you want to say anything about that, your experience from Ayrshire and Arran?
I can, yes. I mean, we recognise the need to develop this role, because there are doctors who, you know, as they decide on their training route, may want a bit more time. But we created these posts to also support and give them some time where they could do further academic study. They could do research as well as provide service. And I think really interestingly, engage with community as well. So we had individuals that would be providing service to local sports clubs, etc. So I think that's just an example, and I know many boards now look at these roles, and that's an excellent way to retain doctors in Scotland, because it gives them that extended opportunity, but it also means they can then consider what their next steps are for their training career. And certainly from the feedback, and of course I've been out of Ayrshire for a couple of years now, but the feedback was excellent from those doctors, and they then saw Ayrshire as a place that, having been supported, having had that opportunity, they would want to come back to in the future, perhaps for a consultant role. And I think that's the sort of programmes that add that value and that retention point that you refer to.
Okay, thank you. Moving on, can you tell us more about what funding arrangements the Scottish Government is putting in place to ensure that Scottish students have access to places in medical courses offered by Scottish universities?
I think that's probably something that we will need to come back to you around the specifics of the funding arrangements. But yeah, we can certainly provide you with that information.
Right. So when you put out an announcement, so there was the one that we're going to have 800 more GPs, is there conversations between NHS, Scottish Government, universities to basically do a workforce plan and to see how many spaces you're going to need in those courses?
Yes, yeah, so to take the GP programme as an example, so one of the things that we have done there, so we have increased the number of medical school places. So we've increased the number of places in medical school overall, but we also set up ScotGem in St Andrews University, which is a graduate programme aimed at people who have a particular interest in primary care, and also through the training elements, a particular focus on remote and rural care as well, recognising that's an area that we need to be able to recruit to. So we set up ScotGem in order to provide that sort of pipeline through medical school over and above the more traditional medical school, which also obviously the people that come through that route who want to train to be GPs. We've now increased, so we then have to increase the specialty training pipeline, so the numbers of training places that are available for people in the specialty, in the GP specialty programme. As of 2022, I think the total numbers available in that programme were 326, and we recruited to 322 of those places. So that's probably the highest fill rate that we've had for GP, I think, for a number of years, possibly since records began, actually. But I will check that and get back to you on that detail. And I think that's an indication of the fact that we have increasingly managed to develop a strong pipeline through to general practice. These things take some time, because you've got to encourage students through medical school and then provide the places, but also, you know, the good quality experiences through that specialty training as well.
So if you're doing workforce planning and you see that there's a gap and you need more students on certain courses, you do have conversations with universities?
Yeah, absolutely. So the conversations happen with the universities around the undergraduate to take medicine around undergraduate medical places and the numbers that are required there, and then through NHS education, NHS education works with the specialty boards to look at what the projected requirements are for consultants in each specialty. We've had a particular focus on GP there, obviously, in order to make sure that we're students coming through medical school then have the opportunity to train in the specialties that we know we're going to need.
Okay. I know one of the big issues with universities is that there's obviously it's free education in Scotland, and there's been talk of less Scottish students being able to get in the courses because they're having to take students on that are basically paying fees. And again, I don't know how true this is, but I did hear in one recent dentistry course that was completed, there was only three people in the course that were actually Scottish. The rest were international. But I can't say that that's actual fact. That's what I was told. So... would you be able, I know you won't have them just now, but would you be able to give us figures showing how many places Scottish students are actually getting on, like, medicine, dentistry, pharmacy, and if there's any update on the completion rates of those as well, so that we can see how many Scottish students are actually completing courses in our universities that can stay on?
Yeah,
I wouldn't have it just now. But...
No, I definitely don't have it in front of me right now. I'm also just going to say that we are dependent on the universities for that breakdown. Mm-hmm. But I will check with colleagues whether we're able to get that from the universities for you.
Yeah, that's fine. Thank you. Could you also tell us whether the Scottish Government agrees that the target to increase GP workforce by 800 by 2027-2028 is on track?
So I've just, as I've, in my previous answer, I've told you about some of the things that we're doing to build towards that. And I think it is really encouraging that the trainee numbers in 2022 were up to 322 people now on training courses to be on that specialty training programme to be GPs, which is a three-year programme. So I think that we are building towards those numbers. What I would say is that we've also put a huge amount of investment into increasing the multidisciplinary team around GPs and the team that support GPs, so pharmacists, advanced nurse practitioners, physiotherapists, to support GPs in order to be enabled really to free GPs up to do that sort of expert generalist role within their practices. We are up to 3,220 people who've been recruited to those multidisciplinary teams across Scotland.
Okay. And do you have any figures as well? We've got the figure of it's 800 GPs, but it's headcount. Whereas what I hear as well is there's a lot of GPs that are now going part-time. So if you've got 800 GPs that are working 5 days a week, that's one thing. If you've got 800 GPs that are only working 3 days a week, then that takes about, I think it's 300 GPs off your figure. So it's just so that it's not misleading. We say that we've got 800 GPs, but if we recruit GPs and they're all working part-time, then we're not actually getting those full-time equivalent GPs into...
Yeah, so I absolutely accept your question, and clearly that, you know, we do have an issue in terms of people increasingly, particularly in general practice, wanting to work less than full time. Again, I will see if we have that in information, because again that would need to come from individual GP practices.
Okay, thanks. And my last question: how successful the Scottish Government's international recruitment strategy has been to date, and whether international recruitment will form part of future workforce plans?
So I think our international recruitment strategy has been really successful to date. We, as I think I mentioned earlier, we had recruited 200 staff by August last year, and that encouraged us enough to put some additional investment in to enable boards to recruit up to an additional 750. And that early indications are that we will certainly meet those numbers, and that some boards actually have taken the opportunity to go further than that, because clearly, again, that's a resource that they can balance off against the need to use agency staff. I think the feedback from NHS boards, many NHS boards are finding that a really helpful and useful resource. However, that's not uniform across Scotland. I think there are areas of Scotland, particularly where housing is a challenge, where it's been more difficult to bring people in from overseas.
Okay, and just again on the retention side, are you looking, because it's an extra premium when you're taking on international staff, are you looking or tracking the retention rates for international staff compared to domestic staff?
Yes, we are looking at how we can ensure that we keep international staff, albeit they may want to move around Scotland.
Okay.
I'm going to bring in Craig Hoy in a second, but just before I do that, we've spoken about the number of GPs and recruitment and retention and so on, but one of the issues that the committee was quite exercised by last year, and we took up with you in correspondence, was that broader picture of GP data. Because if I can characterise it as, on the one hand, we've got GPs saying, we're seeing more patients than ever, and on the other, our post bags are full of people saying, I can't get an appointment with a GP. So I think we were quite keen to have some transparency over that. And I don't know, and so we certainly corresponded with you, Caroline Lamb, about, I think, an oversight group that you had put together that was, I think, was an attempt to try to get into some of that granular detail. And I just wondered whether you could update us on that work.
Yeah, absolutely. I would say I share your keenness to have access to that level of granular data. We have a wealth of data around our acute sector performance, but we have had to put in place mechanisms to build our data in other parts of the system. Social care is another area, but primary care is certainly one as well. So I think when we met last year, Sir Lewis Ritchie was chairing an oversight group which was looking at data within primary care. Public Health Scotland have been working on mechanisms to make that data available from individual GP systems. I think probably at the moment, whilst we have managed to, they have produced some publications around GP activity and have managed to make that available both at a national level and at an NHS board level. What I would say is I think we have some issues in the quality of that data because of things being coded differently in different GP practices. So there is still some work to do on that. We have now started the rollout of the next generation of IT to GP practices, and we hope that that will help to improve both the ease of extracting data out of GP systems, but also give us a bit of a position to be able to start with a bit of a clean slate around how data is coded. But it is an extremely challenging position, and I talked about the multidisciplinary teams earlier and how we need to be able to track not just that activity in the patient contact from the GP perspective, but also recognising that it's often much more appropriate for somebody to see a physio or a pharmacist rather than a GP. But again, I think we all share that desire to be able to really understand that data and therefore understand where our opportunities for improvement are.
Okay, thanks. I mean, obviously, as a public audit committee, we are interested in the public accountability of that service. And the only way we can get that is by having that data and having that degree of transparency. And so I think, if I could just re-emphasise, you may share our frustration, but if I could just re-emphasise to you that we do think that's extremely important because it is, for many people, their access point to the National Health Service. Craig Hoy, you've got a question.
Thanks, Richard. Just in follow-up to, I think, one of the deputy convener's questions in relation to staff retention. I attended last year a roundtable with the RCN, the chief nurse, the former cabinet secretary for health, and frontline nurses. And one of the things that struck me was that simple but presumably effective mechanisms like exit interviews weren't necessarily being routinely deployed throughout the service. So just be interesting to get a confirmation that that is now the case and that we're perhaps using more of those tried and tested practices. But do you think you have a sufficient handle as to why people are leaving nursing, for example, and how responsive are you being to those key the key messages that you're getting as to why people are leaving the service?
Sorry, excuse me. I think that there's more we can do around being clear about the reasons why people might choose to leave nursing and therefore to get a better understanding about what more we can do to keep them. We have recently established a nursing and midwifery task force, which is looking at a number of the issues around both recruitment and retention and the opportunities for how we best use our nursing and midwifery workforce. And that's one of the things that task force is looking at.
So would it be fair to say that you think at this point in time you're not doing enough to capture the information as to why people are leaving?
I think we could definitely improve the data that we have available to us. Yep.
Okay, thanks.
At a board level and at a national level.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to turn for the final series of questions this morning to Bill Kidd. Bill, I'm going to bring you back in.
Thank you very much, convener. Just a wee bit about reform and innovation and how that's being used by the Scottish Government and NHS boards. There's necessity, as I think you've said, that there's a need to monitor public awareness and acceptance of new ways of assessing services to make sure that they're effective. I might need to go myself to a hospital. Hold on a second, if you don't mind. I do like a bit of melodrama. Can I ask, looking at the fact that the public need to realistically understand what is being achieved and to try and involve them in difficult choices, how effective is the Scottish Government's redesign of urgent care programme been to in reducing the number of people who self-present to hospital and feedback therefore received from patients about the service changes that have been made?
To take that one.
Yeah, I'll take that one. So I think the redesign of urgent care has been a successful programme. And I think it's an area that we need to continue to evolve and develop. Why I think it's been successful, and of course, you know, looking at the period of the pandemic and trying to just make sure we're comparing effectively, but we have seen a reduction in self-presenting attendances, and that was always the intent, was that we would see a reduction in self-presenting attendances. But I think that's a number of factors that have supported that. I think firstly, the work that NHS 24 undertake and the NHS Inform, we know that's accessed, I think for March, I think the figure was around 12 million. People access the NHS Inform and for that able to access self-help guides. But I think we've also had very effective communication with the public over time about right care, right place and how to access services. Whether that is your general practice, and I say that because it could be a nurse or a pharmacist or a physio, or whether that's your community pharmacy, and we've seen some excellent progress in terms of the important role that community pharmacy plays. But we've also, I think, through the redesign of urgent care, introduced flow navigation centres across every board in Scotland so that individuals may be referred by NHS 24 to the flow navigation centre, but they then will be either directed or redirected again to the right care, which isn't always needing to attend an A&E department. I think the final thing I would want to comment on is the excellent work that Scottish Ambulance Service have made in relation to firstly, the clinical advice that they can provide when someone calls. Secondly, the ability for their skilled paramedics and staff to manage and provide care at an individual's home and avoid conveyance to hospital. But also by getting support through the flow navigation in a peer-to-peer conversation. So all of those factors, I think, have impacted and allowed us to provide care differently that avoids unnecessary admission or attendance at an accident emergency department.
Thank you. I mean, this then, we must assume, has a lot to do with monitoring public awareness then, actually, of the changes which are being made and their acceptance of these new ways of accessing services to ensure that that's being effective. I mean, you've said there about there have been changes and that we do know that that the professionals are seeing how this works? Is the public awareness of this, though, as great, and can it be improved in order that the care and wellbeing portfolio can bring about the reform necessary to improve public health outcomes? So the monitoring and the reportage that comes from that can actually give us all sort of comfort that this is actually achieving what it's there to do. Is the public aware of these changes enough?
Yes, I think we've each year and consistently for a number of years had public messaging, marketing that signals has signalled those changes. We've also done leaflet drops to every household in Scotland in the past, setting out that range of services. Most recently, and I should have made reference to this earlier, is but we have introduced an NHS 24 online app. So again, with access to self-help guides through the app, and that's an area that we're developing. And certainly is an area that we think has further opportunity to both make more accessible services, as people tend to look to and use apps perhaps more readily for accessing information. So that's an important development that we will continue. But we will also know through the some of the evaluation of the marketing that has been impactful in terms of how people across Scotland have looked to use and access services. And so I do think that, and when we look at our own data, we're seeing that shift in where care is being accessed. So there's always more you can do in measuring the impact, and we will want to stay sighted, because as we progress urgent care, and I think there will be more we can do in terms of some of the pathways of care, where we can support people in a different way. We'll continue to do that. We'll need to make sure that we're continuing to ensure that our understanding and data collection and reporting of that impact is matching and following those changes.
That's helpful. Thank you very much. Thank you, convener. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Well, that pretty much brings us to the close of the session. I think there were just two things I wanted to highlight in the report, which I'd welcome your views on. One is this whole agenda for reform. I mean, the clear message from the Auditor General is the level of funding for the NHS at £19 billion is at a record level, but yet we are still continuing to see outcomes at a suboptimal level. So I guess the debate about what we need to do to change, to reconfigure services is something which is central to that, and some of this goes back to the Christie Commission of over 10 years ago about that preventative agenda and that broader view of public health, not just the institution of the National Health Service. But that really does rest upon public debate and engagement. So I guess it would be useful for us to find out from you in closing what your perspective on that is and what your plans are for that. The other thing related to that is, again, one of the key recommendations in the report, and you said that you accepted those recommendations, was that you should publish annual progress updates on service reform. Is it your intention to do that?
So, sorry. So, you know, I absolutely agree, I think, with your analysis there, that this is about tackling the broader public health issues. But it's also then about how we provide, and I said it earlier in the response to a question from Craig Hoy, it's also about how we provide services differently, how we use innovation and technology to provide services closer to people in their homes, and how we provide services in a much more preventative way. So the example of the closed-loop diabetes example is a clear example of where we can actually prevent people's health from deteriorating by using relatively simple technologies. I think in terms of looking at how we publish our progress in relation to innovations, then We do some of that already. So we produced a publication after the pandemic around how we'd use digital health and technologies to deliver services differently during the pandemic. A lot of those things remain in place. So NHS Near Me and the huge increase in the use of that would be an example of all of that. So I think that it's very useful for us to make available some of the evidence around the impact of that innovative... sorry, I'm suffering from your complaint. So the evidence of some of that innovative work, whether that's a sort of annual report or whether that's focusing on different areas of activity, I think it's something we'd want an opportunity to think about. I'm sorry.
That's OK, but I take it from that that your answer isn't yes, that you do accept that recommendation the Auditor General.
I accept the recommendation that we need to be able to publish information about the impact that innovation and changes the way in which we deliver service can make. Whether I think that needs to be a sort of dry annual report or whether there are ways of doing that differently, I think that's something that we would want to reflect on.
I'm sure the Auditor General wasn't suggesting a dry annual report, but something that will be informative and would help people to understand the progress that has been made. Because, of course, we've highlighted some of the areas where we've got concerns, but there are, as you said at the start, not least thanks to the workforce, some extremely critical work that's going on out there. And I think, as a committee, we would like to add a record of our thanks to yours for the incredible work that the staff providing those services do day in, day out, night in, night out. So on that note, I would like to close this morning's session and thank Caroline Lamb, thank you, Richard McCallum and John Burns for your input this morning. It's been very useful to us. There were some areas, I think, where you said you might get back to us with a bit more detail in your answers, and that would be most welcome. So can I thank you again, and I'll now draw the committee public session to a close and move us into private session.